This episode of One Hit Thunder is brought to you by DistroKid.
We'll make the bet up straight. I always stay out late. I never take you out. Ask what you're all about. I always smell like smoke. Everything's just a joke. I never look at you when you come hear me sing. These are not all of me.
With the 25th anniversary of Jimmy's Chicken Shack's album Bring Your Own Stereo upon us, we're diving into their eclectic catalog, spotlighting their 1999 single, Do Right. Known for running the full gamut of musical styles, sometimes to the point where it might be too much, the band's versatility is both a strength and a challenge. Depending on your perspective, Jimmy's Chicken Shack might be a one-hit wonder, a two-hit wonder, or a no-hit wonder. Join us this week as we explore what they did right and what they did wrong.
I never talk to you, be who you want me to. My music's way too loud, my friends are all so proud.
One hit is all you need to make the money guaranteed. And you can live off royalties forever.
And it makes me wonder, is it just a wonder or is it one hit thunder?
All right, Matt, we're here today to talk about Jimmy's Chicken Shack. Which song are we talking about?
I went with Do Right.
Right. I think that's the better song of the two big ones.
I think it's the better song from the two big ones.
But I don't know if it's the biggest one.
Well, here's the thing with Jimmy's Chicken Shack. For starters, finding information about any of their chart history is like borderline impossible.
Okay.
Secondly,
are they a no-hit wonder?
They're kind of a no-hit wonder. Like they're a an MTV one-hit wonder. Uh-huh. Do Right was on like TRL and had some success. When I was trying to do any research, this is of all the episodes that we've been recording for the last couple weeks where we're face to face, the only thing that I was able to find was this. Do Right is their biggest song in the sense that it actually charted somewhere.
Okay.
So it peaked at number 12 on the modern rock chart in 1999. And instead of trying to dig through the modern rock chart to find anything about the week that it peaked, instead I wanted to talk about the number ones that year in modern rock.
What year is this?
1999.
Oh, okay.
We've done a lot of these where throughout the year there's like 20 songs mm-hmm. that were the number one hit, right? We've got 8 songs for the entire year of 1999 that were the number one modern rock songs.
Okay.
So it started with Everlast, What It's Like.
Okay.
That was there from December 26th until February 27th. So 2 straight months of Everlast. So I like that song. This song's all right.
Yeah, I don't really like it, but okay.
Followed by Sugar Ray Every Morning.
Okay.
That was the number one song from March 6th until April 10th.
Okay.
Then Lit, My Own Worst Enemy, April 10th until June 26th.
Wow, big one.
Huge. Followed immediately by Red Hot Chili Peppers' Scar Tissue from June 26th until October 16th.
What?
Yeah.
People like that song that much?
That was that much. And then
jeez.
From October 16th to December 11th, this was equally weird. The number one song just kept changing hands between these three songs over and over again, which was Creed Higher, Bush's Chemicals Between Us, and Foo Fighters Learn to Fly. Like it just was like those three songs over and over again. Every week was a different one. Then Limp Bizkit's Rearrange was 1 week on December 18th. And then lastly, on Christmas Day, December 25th, Blink-182 had an 8-week period with the number one song being All the Small Things.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's the landscape of 1999 when Do Right made its appearance on the charts.
Yeah. It snuck onto the charts briefly. Here's what I will say about Jimmy's Chicken Shack out the gate. But I have a podcasting friend who lives fairly close to where the band Jimmy's Chicken Shack comes from. And he has told me on multiple occasions that the main guy of Jimmy's Chicken Shack, Jimmy Haha,
yeah,
is a real piece of shit.
Wow. Okay.
So I've kind of gone into Jimmy's Chicken Shack since then with slightly tainted opinions. He hasn't given me any examples, just like, yeah, he's not a great dude.
Well, let's be fair.
This is hearsay.
that's hearsay, and also no specific examples. Yep. Like, someone could call someone a piece of shit because they're difficult to work with in the studio, or they could call them a piece of shit because they commit serious crimes. Yeah. So this is...
We have no... Yeah, so I'm just saying we got no examples, just I've heard he's not great, like just not a fun dude in general.
Not fun dude, okay.
But what I will say is that I own... 3 Jimmy's Chicken Shack albums.
Wow.
And I like one of them.
Okay. Do you like the one that Do Right is on?
I do. I actually think Bring Your Own Stereo has some cool songs on it.
Okay.
I cannot say the same for the album before it or the album after it. So the story of Jimmy's Chicken Shack, they start in 1993 and they put out a debut like indie album only on cassette type thing. Like they're trying to build a name for themselves. They recorded it for $600. And that was after the band had only been together for 6 months. They make this demo. They follow that up the next year with another album. This time they only recorded it for $400. Mm-hmm. And then deciding that, you know, that they kind of are known for their like very energetic live show, they say, let's record some of our live shows, and that's what we're going to pass around. Mm-hmm. So they started making these live show tapes, and this is what gets them eventually signed to Island Records. And that's where they get the major label debut of pushing the Salmonella envelope. Now on MTV's 120 Minutes.
Terrible album name.
Terrible album name.
Terrible band name, too.
Unless, not a great band name.
Is there an actual Jimmy's Chicken Shack?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Have you seen, do you know the album cover for pushing the Salmonella envelope?
I think I saw it in doing the research for this. I didn't really like look close. It's a draw. It's like a... cartoon.
It's a cartoon of a guy shaking a pill bottle into his hand, and it's all chicken feathers.
Oh, it was chicken feathers. I couldn't tell. Like, I was just seeing it on my phone or whatever. I was like, are those like jagged pills? Jagged little pills?
No, yeah. It's chicken feathers. And they had the song High. They made a music video for it, played on MTV's 120 Minutes. And it hit 10 on something called the Active Rock Charts, which I don't know what the hell the Active Rock Charts are.
I've seen that before. I don't know. But that song, what I will say, because we don't have actual chart numbers for Jimmy's Chicken Shack, that song has way more YouTube plays than Do Right.
Which is crazy to me, because I think that's the lesser of the singles in my mind.
But I knew both of these songs.
I feel like this was a band where you either discovered them through High or you discovered them from Do Right. And whichever one it was that you knew first is like, you're kind of just like, oh, that was the hit.
That guitar riff from that song High is so recognizable.
Yeah. It's definitely a riff that you know. But I...
Or does it just sound like a lot of other things?
I think it just sounds like a lot of other things, to be honest. But then we get to this second album, Bring Your Own Stereo. And I think I remember seeing the video for High like once on MTV and just being like, whatever. I remember this song, like seeing this video for the first time on MTV. And it's not like a particularly impressive video.
They talk
over most of the video. But I was like, this song rules. Like, I really, really like the song. And I went out and bought the album, and me and my friends, we were in middle school. This is a perfect middle schooler album. Mm-hmm. The song right before this is a song called Lazy Boy Dash.
Uh-huh. I listened to the whole album, yeah.
I think that song's fun enough. The son, you better get up, while you can. What I think is the compliment I will give Jimmy's Chicken Shack is I think that they really were trying to bleed a bunch of genres together. Like, you have songs that kind of like jump all over the place, but I also think it makes it a hard listen.
Dude.
Because it's all over the map.
Dude, there were some bands like this in the 90s in Pittsburgh where, it's kind of like, when I listen to their music, I'm like, what is this?
Yeah.
I can't figure it out. Like, there's parts that are like almost like reggae sometimes. And then there's like, then it's heavy. Then it's like funky. Then it's, I don't know. Like, to be honest, Do Right, this might sound crazy, but I feel like his delivery and some of like, I don't know, the melodies and music, it almost reminds me of like Ben Folds 5 or something.
I could see a little bit of that. Let me tell you who they went on tour with. So the single Do Right is the only song of theirs ever make it onto MTV's Total Request Live. And MTV even selected the song to be part of the Buzz Bin. And the success of the song helped land them tours with bands like 311,
okay,
Live, Everclear, Creed, Fuel, and Finger 11. Of that list of bands, I would say 311 and Finger 11, the 11s, seem to make the most sense to me with their style.
311 makes sense for sure, but at least with 311, like them or hate them, you kind of know what. I think they got it a little bit more dialed in than Jimmy's Chicken Shack does.
They have their own sound for sure, but I agree with you. Like 311 found that weird blend of, all right, we're doing this like rock and roll guitar and there's going to be some rapping, but like when it goes into like the reggae upstrokes thing, it doesn't feel like such a dramatic twist. They were really good at like making that kind of flow in and out better than like Jimmy's Chicken Shack. Across 12 tracks feels like it's written by five different bands.
I know. I feel like the voice doesn't even. It was hard. I respect bands trying to be original and unique or whatever, but I don't think it's that original if you're just like just jamming things together that don't make sense. To be honest, when I listened to Do Right and the other song,
Hi,
I was like, I'm probably going to like this band.
Yeah.
Like these, I like Do Right the most probably,
yeah.
But I thought like, oh, if these are their radio singles, they'll be good. But I was like, I had to turn it off.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Let's talk about Do Right for a second, because I think that song out the gate works for me, mm-hmm. Right? You get that like, it's like a full drum intro type thing, right? Like it's like a brum. Mm-hmm. And then it's that over and over again with him singing these opening lyrics that are like describing the situation. And it's, we'll make the bed up straight. I always stay up late. I never take you out. And that's what you're all about. I always smell like smoke. I make everything a joke. I never look at you when you come hear me sing. These are not all of the many simple things you find wrong with me. Once could you tell me, please, what I do right? Mm-hmm. And that's like the whole point of the song is just like an argument with a girlfriend that's always pointing out the things that you're not good at doing,
yeah.
And being like, please tell me one thing that I do right. I don't know if I like this song lyrically as much as I did as a kid. As a kid, I loved this song.
I mean, when you were reading them, now it's not fair to just read lyrics like a poem, because poems and lyrics, some might argue that they are basically the same thing. They're not, because when you're writing a poem, you don't really have to worry as much about consonant and vowel sounds and the way things flow. So you gotta, I'm not going to hold that against it, but I just want to say when you were reading those lyrics, I wasn't too impressed. But
yeah, let's look at this. Tell me if this sounds like a cool dude that you would want to hang out with.
Oh, wow. Okay.
His bed's never made up straight.
Mm.
He always is staying up late. He never takes his girlfriend out.
Okay.
He always smells like smoke.
Mm.
He turns everything into a joke. He doesn't look at his girlfriend when he sings songs at shows and she's in the crowd. And then the next verse he says, I never talk to you or be who you want me to. My music's too loud and my friends are too proud. You say I'm wasting hope and I can't thread the rope. You see my pocket's broke and you don't see a ring. I'm like, I think this dude's actually just a douchebag complaining about, like, it just feels like 80s stand-up comedy that's like complaining about their wife to
me. Okay. All right. I'm not going to hold this song against him. I, to be honest, I didn't pay attention to the lyrics at all when I was listening to the song. I liked the melody and the feel of the song, and I knew the what do I do part.
Which is like 90% of the song,
yeah,
honestly.
And to be honest, I kind of like it. Not enough that I would put it on a playlist.
No.
Let's be honest. But it's not like painful for me to listen to,
no,
or something.
Compared to, I think some of the other songs on their albums are rough. Because it's just, it's not good. And this is a band that dealt with a lot of record label issues, but I don't think that the record label issues are why they didn't have more hits. I think that it was impossible to market this band to a specific audience because it was too all over the place. I would say in a similar vein, a band that I know people who really like this band And I've heard songs by this band that I like, but I think they also fall into like a how the fuck do you market this band was like a group like Zebrahead mm-hmm. that just like just took too many wild swings from song to song where it's like, how do you introduce a band to somebody that sounds like they're playing four different genres across a single album because there's a higher percent chance that someone only likes a quarter of the album now.
That's the hard part. I mean, I do like having, like, when bands have range.
Yeah.
And it doesn't all sound like the same thing, but it has to have a through line.
Yeah.
And I was definitely missing the through line with these guys. I thought I was going to like more songs.
Well, you said Ben Folds. Ben Folds 5 is a great example, I think, of, like, Army certainly doesn't sound like Smoke.
Yeah.
But it's undeniable that it's the same band.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I think Ben Folds is better at kind of threading that needle of like doing a bunch of different genres, but it never not sounding like Ben Folds 5. I think that Jimmy's Chicken Shack barely sounds like Jimmy's Chicken Shack.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know what their sound is.
Yeah.
It's too much for me or not enough for me. I don't know, man. I actually tried. I thought I was, after I heard this song, I thought I was going to like it. Obviously, I know that the album cover. I don't know like why I saw this album cover so much. Like
I definitely this was an album cover that stuck out to me. It's like the flying car yeah. in outer space with all the band members in it.
Yeah, yeah. yeah. It's another drawing.
They love those animated covers, man.
Hey there, One Hit Thunder listeners. Are you ready to take your music to the next level? Well, get ready to rock because this episode is brought to you by DistroKid, the ultimate digital music distribution service for artists like you. With DistroKid, you can easily upload your songs or albums to online stores and streaming platforms like Spotify, Apple Music, and YouTube Music, reaching fans all around the globe. But that's just the beginning. DistroKid offers a ton of awesome features like Hyperfollow, which helps you promote your releases and get pre-saves on your songs all for free. But wait. There's more. The DistroKid app is now available on iOS and Android. With the app, you can manage your releases, track your streaming stats, and even withdraw your earnings, all from the palm of your hand. And for those looking to perfect their sound, check out Mixia. This powerful tool allows you to put the finishing touches on your tracks in minutes, ensuring they sound polished and professional every time. But that's not all. DistroKid has just launched a brand new feature called Instant Share, allowing you to easily share large files securely with collaborators, producers, and more. With Instant Share, you can keep your music streaming at the highest quality while making the best impression possible. So what are you waiting for? Elevate your music career today with DistroKid and unlock a world of possibilities. Possibilities that I know all about because I've been using DistroKid for years. It's seriously great. If you haven't used it before, you're going to love it. And One Hit Thunder listeners get an exclusive offer, 30% off your first year with DistroKid by signing up at distrokid.com/VIP/OneHitThunder. That's distrokid.com/VIP/OneHitThunder.
Bowie, Dylan, Marley. You've heard the names and maybe you've heard their songs, but what about the stories behind the records that made titans of music like these so universally loved and important? Join me, Josh Adam Myers, host of The 500, as each week I go through a different album from Rolling Stone Magazine's 500 Greatest Albums list from 2012 with an incredible lineup of comedians, actors, and musicians talking about how the music has impacted their lives. New episodes of The 500 come out every Wednesday. Listen now wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, One Hit Thunders, Thunderheads, Thunder Buns. All right, I'll just go with One Hit Thunder listeners. This is Chris DeMakes, guitarist and vocalist for Less Than Jake, and host of Chris DeMakes a Podcast, a songwriting podcast where every week I'm joined by an amazing guest to break down the writing, recording, and release of one iconic song that they have written. In our giant evergreen back catalog of episodes, we've had rock legends such as Dee Snider and Huey Lewis, punk rock favorites such as Mark Hoppus, Fat Mike, and Brett Gurewitz. Up-and-coming artists of today such as Liz Stokes of The Beths and Genesis Owusu. And even some of the artists that have been featured on One Hit Thunder. The show is even produced by One Hit Thunder host Chris Fafalius. What more could you possibly ask for? Chris DeMakes a Podcast is available for free on all the places you listen to podcasts. And new episodes come out every Monday. I guarantee you'll like it or we'll give you your money back.
I want to go back to the music video for a second. Bands, you
This is back to Soul Decision again. Like, don't cover up your music video with noise.
That's the other one. Yeah. You don't need to put sound effects and talking. Like, you want to hear the song.
I remember there was a thing in like 99, 2000 seems like right in the ballpark of it, where like people would do like, this is our silly video. Like, they're doing like a goofy, like, this video is kind of like a little bit of a Looney Tunes. We're doing like a live action Looney Tunes. But then the whole song is filled with like boink noises and shit to like match the cartoonish aspect of what they're trying to recreate.
What is this? What is this that you're alluding to?
Well, you know what I mean? Like, you know how like in like a Looney Tunes cartoon, like,
I know what you're talking about, but what music videos were doing?
I don't remember. I'm just saying, I know that there was like this time period where people were doing these, like, they're like, our video is kind of like a live action cartoon. And like part of that was putting cartoon sound effects over moments. I mean, that happened a little bit in the Soul Decision video too, to be fair. Like, them, it had like that Looney Tunes cartoon aspect of them just like picking up the bench where he's like writing a song without him realizing it.
Right.
But it was just like, they would do shit like that all the time in like the late 90s, early 2000s, before September 11th came and made us all very serious about how we took our music videos for a little bit.
Yeah.
Even Eminem, I feel like early Eminem videos, he would throw sound effects all over. There's one, Role Model. Pretty sure Role Model, there's a scene because he mentions Foghorn Leghorn where he's in a cartoon with a cartoon chicken. And during that entire part, it's like cartoon sound effects from the video.
Okay.
Like covering up what's happening.
Yeah, that's not right.
Yeah.
That's unnecessary.
Even Weird Al, I think, did this when he, you know, not that I like promoting that this guy did anything with Weird Al because it seems like such a conflict of interest. But John Kay of Ren and Stimpy fame drew a music video for Weird Al.
Really? Yeah, he did a Bjork video too.
Yeah, and it's just filled with cartoon sound effects over top of the song.
Wow. Who'd have thought? Did you watch that Ren and Stimpy documentary?
I haven't yet, but I threw it on my Letterbox wish list because I want to see it.
It's on Tubi.
Oh, I didn't know it was on Tubi. Okay, well then I'm going to make it a much bigger... Yeah. I mean, he's a piece of shit.
I mean, it's crazy. It's called Happy Happy Joy Joy,
yeah,
I think.
That's the one I have.
He's in it.
Yeah.
And all the people that he worked with, and
he has like a cult of people that worked with him that, like, because I listened to the Ren and Stimpy commentary tracks, and let me tell you what's fucked up about the Ren and Stimpy commentary tracks. Like, you know that I love a commentary track. I love to learn about how something was made. John Kay was fired from Ren and Stimpy before the first season was done. He's on the commentary tracks for all three seasons. And on the seasons that he's on, for the stuff that he was fired for, his entire commentary track is talking shit on the cartoon and saying how he would have done it better and how like Nickelodeon fucked up and that they lost the G. Like, he's just like pumping himself up for two and a half seasons. And I'm like, why would you do this? Like, why would you put someone who had nothing to do with the final product on the commentary track?
Yeah, well, also, he did have something to do with, like, the season two. He, like, wrote some of them or whatever.
Yeah, he got fired early in season two because he couldn't deliver season one, I think was what it came down to.
All the stuff about him being, like, a crazy tyrant.
The girl that he was dating is on the commentary tracks with him.
The underage girl?
Yeah.
Well, she's in the documentary,
and
too.
And he talks about, like, oh, yeah, no, she would send me animation, and we would hang, like, I'm like, this is creepy. Why are you, like, it's just, like, confessions on audio podcast.
In the documentary, you see all the stuff about, look, as a creator, he was, like, a creative genius. He created what is, like, my favorite cartoon. Yeah. Like,
the influence that he had across the board on Nicktoons. I was listening to my girlfriend's kids talk about SpongeBob SquarePants.
Yeah, well, that was...
And they were talking about, like, oh, you know when he does, like, the close-up and his face is all crusty and gross? And in my head, I'm like, you have no clue.
That's 100% right. Yeah, Ren Stimpy started all that stuff. But all the stuff aside about, like, him being terrible to work for and crazy in that way, look, I don't want to work for him, but I could almost be like, okay, there's a lot of people who, you could watch the Miyazaki documentary and be like, wow, he is pretty harsh on, or whatever. I'm not saying I like it, but I could be whatever. But nonchalant he was about the pedophile stuff.
Yeah, it's weird.
He's just completely on this documentary about him about that. He's just kind of like, I'm sorry about that. Like, he's like, I would like to tell her I'm sorry. I apologize for that. Like, but he's so nonchalant about it. And
that's
she's
so weird.
And she's on the documentary too. Like, yeah, he ruined my life. It was horrible. Like, I was a kid and like, it's just so weird.
That's so weird.
It is so weird how he's just kind of like, eh.
It does taint things. Like, yeah. I haven't watched this yet. I was curious about the, I was actually meaning to bring this up to you, but I'll bring it up now. Cause you're like a Bjork super fan.
Yeah.
And I know that you love the movie Dancer in the Dark, but like
Lars von Trier,
but you hear that like he was a Bjork did not have fun making that movie.
No, he's
at all. Like, he's an asshole.
Yeah. He's a little bit of a monster. I think.
And I was listening to a podcast where they were like, it kind of taints what is a masterpiece of a movie, knowing that the person you're following through this movie is having the worst time of their life making this movie with a shitty person.
Yeah.
Like, it becomes like harder to watch for enjoyment when you know that.
We're really off on a tangent, but you didn't happen to see those Lars von Trier, there's part one and part two, Nymphomaniac?
Boy, did I.
Dude.
Those movies are fucking awful.
How are those? I watched the whole thing, both of them.
Yeah. They used to be on Netflix. It's wild that those were movies I could stream on Netflix at one point.
They're just straight up porn.
Yeah, starring Shia LaBeouf.
Yeah. I was so confused. I mean, whatever. If you want to watch porn, you can watch porn anytime you want on your phone. But like, how? I was the whole time, I'm like, what is going on?
I mean,
did
you ever see Antichrist?
You know,
that movie starts with a close up of a hard dick going in and out of somebody.
Yeah.
I'm just like, what is this? Yeah. Why am I doing, like, I think I'm tapped out on Lars. I've given three or four.
Oh, you've seen Melancholia.
I haven't seen that. And I haven't seen Dancer in the Dark. Dancer in the Dark is the only one I might still see because I'm told
it's great. I have
it
on
DVD.
Great.
One of the few. The only
I have like a actually pretty decent collection, but compared to Matt's ridiculous hoarder collection, it's not as much. Man, Jimmy's Chicken Shack.
So this is what basically happened with Jimmy's Chicken Shack. By the time Bring Your Own Stereo, which Do Right is on, came out, they were signed to Island Def Jam. This was because after the first album came out, there was changes with members in the band, and then the major label that they were on was purchased by, like, it was another one of those classic, like, they were on Rocket Island, but then it became Rocket A&M, which became Rocket Island again after the sale to PolyGram to the Universal Group. And
isn't
then,
this the same story as Tracy Bonham?
Yeah, it's like the exact same. They were tied up in that exact same situation where they just got shuffled around and thrown on the Death Jam label, which, say what you will about Jimmy's Chicken Shacks jumping around with genres, they shouldn't be on Def Jam. That's not the label that they should be on.
Well,
and this led to, after this album came out, they waited 3 years until they could get out of their contract and go back to self-releasing. That's when they released their third album, Represent.
Uh-huh.
Not Represent. Represent.
And the first, I believe, I don't know if it's the first track, but the single off of this was with the dude from Stain.
Yep, Aaron Lewis from Stain did the single Fallen Out.
Yeah.
And it was released on Kush Records.
Yeah, that song is not good.
No, it's terrible. 4 years later, they released their next album, Falling on Cue, which was released by their own record label, Foul Records. Because, man, did they love a chicken pun.
Yeah.
and then they've basically just been like bouncing back and forth between inactive and like reunion shows, and every once in a while like a very under promoted album will just come out here and there. But their current guitarist at this point in time was the touring guitarist for Candlebox during their final tour. So we could have seen the guitarist from Jimmy's Chicken Shack if we had gone to that Candlebox show when we were recording a Candlebox episode last year.
They're playing. Jimmy's Chicken Shack is playing shows currently. Like, they're still an active band. I respect that. I respect the hustle. I don't have any really specific examples other than Matt's very alluding to someone said, hey, Matt, let's be real here. There could be people out there saying that Chris Mafalius is a piece of shit.
Well, I mean, but that's mostly me.
Yeah. Are you the one telling people that I'm a piece of shit?
You know what it is? I think it's like one of those things where when someone tells you the lead singer of Jimmy's Chicken Shack isn't a great dude, there's somewhere I'm just like, yeah, I believe that. Like, I don't know why, but I don't question it. Like,
yeah, okay.
Like, yeah. And I was like, there's the fact that, like, he's buddies with Aaron Lewis enough to be on his indie release. I'm like, that doesn't rub me great.
That was 20 years ago, though.
That is true. Aaron Lewis was on top of the world. He had introduced It's Been a While into people's vernacular.
Yeah, true.
Trying to think, what was the... Now I'm like, no, that's... Oh, Outside. That, I was like, what was the other Stain song that was huge?
Is that the one with the worst... Krista Banks always talks about how it's the worst performance ever. It's like they released the live version of
it. Was at the Family Values tour, and Fred Durst is just sitting next to him with a microphone yelling shit at the crowd.
Well, he's also singing in unison with him, like not harmonizing with him. They both are just singing this real low.
I'm on the outside.
Man, is that a horrible song. that honestly, like, I know I complain about,
but that song blew an obscure band up. That's the craziest thing I think about
that,
Outside.
I thought it's been a while was there.
No, it was at least okay. So here's what I remember as a kid who was living through it in high school. They had a song called Mud Shovel that was like mildly popular.
That kind of like describes their music.
they
like
had
real Mud Shovel music.
They had a song called Mud Shovel that I remember seeing on like The Box.
Mm-hmm.
And like, if people were really in, I was really into nu metal at that time. People were like kind of into nu metal. They were like, oh yeah, that song's all right. Like, it's got a cool guitar riff or whatever. And then that Family Values live performance happened. And then everybody at school knew who Stain was. Like, everybody. So much so that when they recorded the album with It's Been a While, they had to go back into the studio to record a studio version of Outside to include on it because of how popular that song had become.
Dude, look, maybe I am not rocking it now, but I get why someone would like Limp Bizkit. I get it.
Yeah.
It's fun. There's, you know, the beats are good. There's actually some musicianship there.
I was going to say, I would argue that I've said this before, Fred Durst is arguably the least talented member of that band.
Yeah.
Like, that entire rhythm section is really good.
Yeah, they're like a... I understand why people, obviously, why they... I liked some songs by Limp Bizkit, so I understand it. Stained, I don't understand. I don't get it.
Well, and then it got way worse when Aaron Lewis started doing his, like, crazy country music
aside,
in the last couple of years. But
that aside, I'm not even talking about that. I'm just talking about the music of Stained. It's so fucking terrible.
Yeah. It's not great.
Yeah.
It's not great. Technically, look, I'm just saying, I'm looking at their chart standing, and if we're just going by Billboard Hot 100, Stain's kind of a one-hit wonder for It's Been a While.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It hit number 5 on the Billboard Hot 100, and their next biggest single was So Far Away, like, a decade later, or a couple years later, at 24.
Okay.
So, it's not great. I mean, they're still consistently on rock radio, and I also just don't really feel like doing an episode on Stained ever, but... I think it would bum all of us out.
Yeah.
And I would not want to deal with the people who interact with the podcast complaining about the fact that Stain's not a one-hit wonder.
Yeah. Well, Jimmy's Chicken Shack.
I mean, people might complain about that, too.
About Jimmy's Chicken Shack?
They're like, they're not a one-hit wonder. They're a no-hit wonder.
Yeah, true.
Which is worth noting before we dive into this. Thunder or Blender, Chris?
Oh. I mean... I actually like Do Right. I think it's pretty good. And I think their other single is pretty all right.
Yeah.
And they've kind of kept it together. And they're still a band. But, and this is a big but, I put that album on today that Do Right's on. And I had to, I mean, I put it on like I was doing things, getting prepared for the episode, listening to the album. It's rare that I can't make it through. I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
It was bad.
I mean, I still like that Bring Your Stereo album for a couple tracks. Like I said, I like Lazy Boy Dash. I think there's a song on there called Trash that I don't mind. But I think my days of liking Jimmy's Chicken Shack in 1999 when I was in eighth grade is about the peak of me liking Jimmy's Chicken Shack. So yeah. Chris, it's funny, the audience doesn't know the order in which we're releasing these episodes, but I know the order in which we're recording them, and I think this is the third in a row where we're going to go certified blunder.
Wow. We're both going blunder.
I think we're both going blunder on this one.
All right. Sorry, Jimmy's Chicken Shack. You guys are pretty good. I just don't understand your music.
Yeah. We just don't know what you could do right.
This has been One Hit Thunder. One Hit Thunder is hosted by Chris Ophios of the band Punchline and produced by Matt Kelly of Geekscape.net. Underneath me, you're hearing Green Hills off the Punchline album Lion. Visit punchlinemusic.com for any upcoming news on the band. Our podcast is on Patreon now. Find us at patreon.com/OHTpodcast for early access to episodes, bonus conversations, and a chance to vote on future songs for us to cover. Make sure that you rate, review, and subscribe to us on any of your podcasting apps, and tune in next week for more One Hit Thunder.
It's gonna be different than you ever could have imagined. It's gonna be different. Oh, yeah.
You're listening to the Geekscape Network.
Hey everyone, it's Chris Pandolfi inviting you to check out the new season of my podcast, Inside the Musician's Brain, with new episodes airing now.
Hearing it in that room, these guys playing this thing and trying to figure out how to play this song was mind-blowing. It's so inspiring to know there's so much more to it than you ever thought, and it just opened another door.
But when people find faith because they need to, in terms of just filling a void to feel better without actually being better, that's when it becomes a crutch, much like, you know, drugs and alcohol do.
Man, I don't have all the time in the world here. If I want to be a professional bluegrass musician, I felt like I had to take a very, like, strategic approach, just trying to get rid of the barriers and figure out what those barriers were.
The feelings still come and I have to reckon with that, but I think I have better ways of moving forward and not being stuck, which I think was the killer for me.
Catch all that and so much more on the new season of Inside the Musician's Brain.
This is Chris DeMakes, guitarist and vocalist for Less Than Jake, and host of Chris DeMakes a Podcast, a songwriting podcast where every week I'm joined by an amazing guest to break down the writing, recording, and release of one iconic song from their career. In our giant, evergreen back catalog of episodes, we've had rock legends such as Dee Snider and Huey Lewis, punk rock favorites like Mark Hoppus, Fat Mike, and Brett Gurewitz, and up-and-coming artists of today, such as Liz Stokes of the Beths and Genesis Owusu. We've had guests from all genres and styles of music, and I guarantee that if you peruse our back catalog, you'll see several episodes that'll make you say, man, I gotta hear that. Whether you're a fan of music or a creator of music yourself, you'll take away a whole new appreciation for the songs you know and love. Chris DeMakes a Podcast is available for free on all the places you could possibly listen to podcasts, and new episodes come out every Monday.